Dr. David Kimbrough and Dr. Randall Hughes work to unlock the secrets of the intertidal zone, where the land meets the sea.
Not all disturbances in the salt marsh are catastrophes.
Basically, the seagrass that grows adjacent to the marsh in the bay grows lots and lots of shoots in the summertime, and then in the fall, those shoots sort of slough off. They get tangled together, and they get sort of pushed by the tides up into the marsh. And so as you can see, over time, the seagrass that came in pretty green and healthy is now sort of decaying in place here in the marsh. And you get sort of dead marsh as a result because it gets smothered by all of this wrack.
But there may be more to it than just killing marsh plants.
So is it wrack the destroyer, or is it wrack the nutrient provider? Is it wrack that can degrade and then provide resources to these plants?
To answer this question, Randall's team conducted an experiment in St. Joseph Bay. They set up almost 100 plots with varying densities of wrack.
Yeah, so we typically find at least 1 to 5 juvenile blue crabs in the high density plots. The wrack is providing cover for them, so it's a good habitat.
Oh, there's a snake in there.
That's why we wear the gloves.
One thing the wrack does is it opens up space in the marsh, which there's not often a lot of, and that can actually promote diversity. It can sort of turn over which genetic individuals are present in the marsh and sort of give things a fresh start.
With seagrass beds dying off at an increasing rate, more wrack will be pushed into the marsh as well.
You know, what is the balance of positive and negative of those effects of seagrass wrack, and is it going to become more and more negative as we get more and more wrack into the marsh?
In the Grass on the Reef is funded by the National Science Foundation.